This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Writing of Fiction. Author, Edith Wharton. Chapter 1, In General. Topic 1. To treat of the practice of fiction is to deal with the newest, most fluid, and least formulated of the arts. The exploration of origins is always fascinating. But the attempt to relate the modern novel to the tale of Joseph and his brethren is of purely historic interest. Modern fiction really began when the action of the novel was transferred from the street to the soul, and this step was probably first taken when Madame de Lafayette in the 17th century wrote a little story called La Princesse de Cleves, a story of hopeless love and mute renunciation, in which the stately tenor of the lives depicted is hardly ruffled by the exaltations and agonies succeeding each other below the surface. The next advance was made when the protagonists of this new inner drama were transformed from conventionalized puppets, the hero, the heroine, the villain, the heavy father, and so on, into breathing and recognizable human beings. Here again, a French novelist, the Abbé Prévost, led the way with Manon Lescaut. But his drawing of character seems summary and schematic when his people are compared with the first great figure in modern fiction, the appalling Neveu de Rameau. It was not till long after Diderot's death that the author of so many brilliant tales peopled with 18th-century puppets was found in the creation of that one sordid, cynical, and desolately human figure to have anticipated not only Balzac, but Dostoevsky. But even from Manon Lescaut and the Neveu de Rameau, even from Lesage, Defoe, Fielding, Smollett, Richardson, and Scott, modern fiction is differentiated by the great dividing geniuses of Balzac and Stendhal. Save for that one amazing accident of Diderot's, Balzac was the first not only to see his people physically and morally in their habit as they lived, with all their personal hobbies and infirmities, and make the reader see them, but to draw his dramatic action as much from the relation of his characters to their houses, streets, towns, professions, inherited habits and opinions, as from their fortuitous contacts with each other. Balzac himself ascribed the priority in this kind of realism to Scott, from whom the younger novelist avowedly derived his chief inspiration. But as Balzac observed, Scott, so keen and direct in surveying the rest of his field of vision, became conventional and hypocritical when he touched on love and women. In deference to the wave of prudery which overswept England after the vulgar excesses of the Hanoverian court, he substituted sentimentality for passion, and reduced his heroines to keepsake insipidities. Whereas in the firm surface of Balzac's realism there is hardly a flaw, and his women, the young as well as the old, are living people, as much compact of human contradictions and torn with human passions as his misers, his financiers, his priests, or his doctors. Stendhal, though as indifferent as any 18th-century writer to atmosphere and local color, is intensely modern and realistic in the individualizing of his characters, who were never types, to the extent even of some of Balzac's, but always sharply differentiated and particular human beings. More distinctively still, does he represent the new fiction by his insight into the springs of social action. No modern novelist has ever gone nearer than Racine did in his tragedies to the sources of personal, of individual feeling. And some of the French novelists of the 18th century are still unsurpassed, save by Racine, in the last refinements of individual soul analysis. What was new in both Balzac and Stendhal was the fact of their viewing each character first of all as a product of particular material and social conditions, as being thus or thus because of the calling he pursued, or the house he lived in, Balzac, or the society he wanted to get into, Stendhal, or the acre of ground he coveted, or the powerful or fashionable personage he aped or envied, both Balzac and Stendhal. These novelists, with the solitary exception of Defoe when he wrote Moll Flanders, are the first to seem continuously aware that the bounds of a personality are not reproducible by a sharp black line, but that each of us flows imperceptibly into adjacent people and things. The characterization of all the novelists who preceded these two masters seems, in comparison, incomplete, or immature. Even Richardson seems so, in the most penetrating pages of Clarissa Harlow. Even Goethe's in that uncannily modern novel, The Elective Affinities. Because, in the case of these writers, the people so elaborately dissected are hung in the void, unvisualized and unconditioned, or almost, by the special outward circumstances of their lives. They are subtly analyzed abstractions of humanity, to whom only such things happen, as might happen to almost anyone in any walk of life, the inevitable eternal human happenings. Since Balzac and Stendhal, fiction has reached out in many new directions and made all sorts of experiments, but it has never ceased to cultivate the ground they cleared for it, or gone back to the realm of abstractions. It is still, however, an art in the making, fluent and dirigible, and combining a past full enough for the deduction of certain general principles with a future rich in untried possibilities. Topic 2. On the threshold of any theory of art, its exponent is sure to be asked, on what first assumption does your theory rest? And in fiction, as in every other art, the only answer seems to be that any theory must begin by assuming the need of selection. It seems curious that even now, and perhaps more than ever, one should have to explain and defend what is no more than the rule underlying the most artless verbal statement. No matter how restricted an incident one is trying to give an account of, it cannot but be fringed with details more and more remotely relevant, and beyond that, with an outer mass of irrelevant facts which may crowd on the narrator simply because of some accidental propinquity in time or space. To choose between all this material is the first step toward coherent expression. A generation ago, this was so generally taken for granted that to state it would have seemed pedantic. In everyday intercourse, the principle survives in the injunction to stick to the point. But the novelist who applies, or owns up to applying, this rule to his art is nowadays accused of being absorbed in technique to the exclusion of the supposedly contrary element of human interest. Even now, the charge would hardly be worth taking up, had it not lately helped to refurbish the old trick of the early French realists, that group of brilliant writers who invented the once famous tranche de vie, the exact photographic reproduction of a situation or an episode, with all its sounds, smells, aspects realistically rendered, but with its deeper relevance and its suggestions of a larger whole, either unconsciously missed or purposely left out. Now that half a century has elapsed, one sees that those among this group of writers who survive are still readable in spite of their constricting theory, or in proportion as they forgot about it once they closed with their subject. Such are Maupassant, who packed into his brief masterpieces so deep a psychological significance and so sure a sense of larger relations, Zola, whose slices became the stuff of great romantic allegories in which the forces of nature and industry are the huge cloudy protagonists, as in A Pilgrim's Progress of Man's Material Activities, and the Goncourts, whose French instinct for psychological analysis always made them seize on the more significant morsel of the famous slices. As for the pupils, the mere conscientious appliers of the system, they have all blown away with the theory, after a briefer popularity than writers of equal talent might have enjoyed, had they not thus narrowed their scope. An instance in proof is Phaedo's Fanny, one of the few psychological novels of that generation, and a slight enough adventure in soul-searching compared with the great Madame Bovary, which it was supposed at the time to surpass, but still readable enough to have kept the author's name alive, while most of his minor contemporaries are buried under the unappetizing debris of their slices. It seemed necessary to revert to the slice of life because it has lately reappeared, marked by certain unimportant differences and relabeled the stream of consciousness, and, curiously enough, without its new exponents appearing aware that they are not also its originators. This time, the theory seems to have sprung up first in England and America, but it has already spread to certain of the younger French novelists, who are just now, confusedly, if admiringly, rather overconscious of recent tendencies in English and American fiction. The stream of consciousness method differs from the slice of life in noting mental as well as visual reactions, but resembles it in setting them down just as they come, with a deliberate disregard of their relevance in the particular case, or rather with the assumption that their very unsorted abundance constitutes in itself the author's subject. This attempt to note down every half-aware stirring of thought and sensation, the automatic reactions to every passing impression, is not as new as its present exponents appear to think. It has been used by most of the greatest novelists, not as an end in itself, but as it happened to serve their general design, as when their object was to portray a mind in one of those moments of acute mental stress when it records with meaningless precision a series of disconnected impressions. The value of such effects in making vivid a tidal rush of emotion has never been unknown since fiction became psychological, and novelists grew aware of the intensity with which, at such times, irrelevant trifles impinge upon the brain. But they have never been deluded by the idea that the subconscious, that Mrs. Harris of the psychologists, could in itself furnish the materials for their art. All the greatest of them, from Balzac and Thackeray onward, have made use of the stammerings and murmurings of the half-conscious mind whenever, but only when, such a state of mental flux fitted into the whole picture of the person portrayed. Their observation showed them that in the world of normal men, life is conducted, at least in its decisive moments, on fairly coherent and selective lines, and that only thus can the great fundamental affairs of bread-getting and home and tribe organizing be carried on. Drama, situation, is made out of the conflicts thus produced between social order and individual appetites, and the art of rendering life in fiction can never, in the last analysis, be anything, or need to be anything, but the disengaging of crucial moments from the welter of existence. These moments need not involve action in the sense of external events. They seldom have, since the scene of conflict was shifted from incident to character. But there must be something that makes them crucial, some recognizable relation to a familiar social or moral standard, some explicit awareness of the eternal struggle between man's contending impulses, if the tales embodying them are to fix the attention and hold the memory. Topic 3. The distrust of technique and the fear of being unoriginal, both symptoms of a certain lack of creative abundance, are in truth leading to pure anarchy in fiction. And one is almost tempted to say that in certain schools, formlessness is now regarded as the first condition of form. Not long ago, I heard a man of letters declare that Dostoevsky was superior to Tolstoy because his mind was more chaotic, and he could therefore render more truthfully the chaos of the Russian mind in general. Though how chaos can be apprehended and defined by a mind immersed in it, the speaker did not make clear. The assertion, of course, was the result of confusing imaginative emotivity with its objective rendering. What the speaker meant was that the novelist who would create a given group of people or portray special social conditions must be able to identify himself with them, which is rather a long way of saying that an artist must have imagination. The chief difference between the merely sympathetic and the creative imagination is that the latter is two-sided and combines with the power of penetrating into other minds that of standing far enough aloof from them to see beyond, and relate them to the whole stuff of life out of which they but partially emerge. Such an all-round view can be obtained only by mounting to a height, and that height in art is proportioned to the artist's power of detaching one part of his imagination from the particular problem in which the rest is steeped. One of the causes of the confusion of judgment on this point is no doubt the perilous affinity between the art of fiction and the material it works in. It has been so often said that all art is representation, the giving back in conscious form of the shapeless raw material of experience, that one would willingly avoid insisting on such a truism. But while there is no art of which the saying is truer than of fiction, there is none in respect of which there is more danger of the axioms being misinterpreted. The attempt to give back any fragment of life in painting or sculpture or music presupposes transposition, stylization. To represent in words is far more difficult because the relation is so close between model and artist. The novelist works in the very material out of which the object he is trying to render is made. He must use to express soul the signs which soul uses to express itself. It is relatively easy to separate the artistic vision of an object from its complex and tangled actuality if one has to re-see it in paint or marble or bronze. It is infinitely difficult to render a human mind when one is employing the very word dust with which thought is formulated. Still, the transposition does take place as surely, if not as obviously, in a novel as in a statue. If it did not, the writing of fiction could never be classed among works of art, products of conscious ordering and selecting, and there would consequently be nothing to say about it, since there seems to be no way of estimating aesthetically anything to which no standard of choice can be applied. Another unsettling element in modern art is that common symptom of immaturity, the dread of doing what has been done before. For though one of the instincts of youth is imitation, another, equally imperious, is that of fiercely guarding against it. In this respect, the novelist of the present day is in danger of being caught in a vicious circle, for the insatiable demand for quick production tends to keep him in a state of perpetual immaturity, and the ready acceptance of his wares encourages him to think that no time need be wasted in studying the past history of his art, or in speculating on its principles. This conviction strengthens the belief that the so-called quality of originality may be impaired by too long brooding on one's theme and too close a commerce with the past. But the whole history of that past, in every domain of art, disproves this by what survives, and shows that every subject, to yield and to retain its full flavor, should be long carried in the mind, brooded upon, and fed with all the impressions and emotions which nourish its creator. True originality consists not in a new manner, but in a new vision. That new, that personal vision is attained only by looking long enough at the object represented to make it the writer's own. And the mind which would bring this secret germ to fruition must be able to nourish it with an accumulated wealth of knowledge and experience. To know any one thing, one must not only know something of a great many others, but also, as Matthew Arnold long since pointed out, a great deal more of one's immediate subject than any partial presentation of it visibly includes. And Mr. Kipling's, What Should They Know of England?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.